what led or inspired you to study physics at Oxford Uni and at university and at postgraduate level? And what do you what appealed to you in particular about quantum physics?
You see, my background is actually, my parents are business people. So my background is very much, you know, very much a commercial, the commercial field. But when it came to studying, my father says, study economics and join the business. I said, no. I want to know what is the nitty gritty of reality. How is this world made up? What is the, if you like, the building block of this creation? I wish to study that rather than how to make money. He was quite, you know, upset by that. He said, no, you are a businessman's son. You should focus on money and economy and all that. I said, no, physics. I want to know what is the nitty-gritty of this creation. So my journey started by looking, trying to make sense of the world that we live in a very detailed manner. And the most pretentious of all the sciences is physics. It, in fact, if you want to study any other scientific field, you have to go to physics to sort yourself out. This is where we have the fabric of reality. So I said, I'm going to study physics because I was just attracted to that. So that is my, that is the journey that got me started into physics. But when I was studying physics at Imperial College, I suddenly discovered there's a lot of things that I was discovering, saying at the cutting edge discoveries of modern physics, like quantum mechanics, etc., related very well with some of the deeper teachings of Hinduism. So I was strongly drawn. And the two areas that, you know, immediately caught my attention were the theory of relativity and the theory of quantum physics. And both of them appeared exotic, very tricky, and yet I was strongly drawn by them because I felt this is where I feel like the kind of more deeper vision of physics become visible. That's why I started with physics.
There's often this perceived gap between science and religion, so a kind of conflict between the two. So, for example, the theory of evolution versus like creationism in theology. So have there been any advancements in science that started to lead you to challenge your own personal beliefs in the past?
You see, the challenges that the religions face from science are really the religions that come from the Abrahamic traditions. They struggle. The idea of man, you know, created by God as a special case to come and rule over other animals is a purely an Abrahamic idea, not Indic idea. So the ideas about evolution, etc., offend the Abrahamic tradition in a way it is strongly challenging the Abrahamic tradition. But Hinduism has no problem with issues like that. So we never had issues with science. In fact, let me tell you, the way we define our tradition, which is called Dharma, is simply saying, trying to make sense of the world that we live in. What is the nature of reality? What are the rules that operate in the world outside as well as the rules that operate in the inner man? So our journey was never looking for a God, or never looking for a theistic approach. You simply say, what is the nature of reality? What is this all about? So our approach has always been trying to make sense of the world that we live in. And science does precisely that. So we have no difficulty. We never had any difficulty with science at all. In fact, we flow with science. The way science is defined, the way Dharma is defined is exactly the same. So we have never had any conflict. The Abrahamic tradition is in serious trouble with the challenges from science and rationality. But the Indic tradition, the deeper kind of ideas of Indic traditions are not challenged at all. In fact, they flow with the findings of modern science.
Also, we found many young Hindus look up to you, particularly because your take on Hinduism aligns quite well with their own beliefs. In particular, I find that true about myself. So when you were younger, did you have a role model or someone who you looked up to who maybe inspired the values that you have now?
You see, since very early days, when I was a little boy, I was always drawn to the idea there's something deeper regarding us and the world that we live in. I was always somehow knew intuitively there's something very special about all of us. So I was always drawn to the idea there's something deeper regarding us and the world that we live in. So I was always kind of strongly attracted to this, but then I required some role models who can kind of lead me to this in this direction. So I was looking around, and I'm only interested in those people who are looking at the deeper vision of Hinduism rather than people who are kind of, you know, superficial, you know, kind of focusing on the ritualistic aspect, the narrative aspect, the bhajan and the kathas. That wouldn't attract me at all. So I was looking for a vision that allows me to relate to reality in a more science-oriented, rational worldview. So I was looking around, and there are very few personalities that I could relate to. I was struggling with all these bhajans and kathas and the puranis do not attract me. The priests, the puranis, the pujaris, the pandits don't attract me. So I was looking for the right role model for me to latch on to make spiritual progress. And I was looking around, and a few personalities that immediately caught my attention, because these are people who don't set up sectarian movements and drum beating and big institutions. They are establishing spiritual experience, and those personalities attracted me right from the very young age, from the age of 11. in the personality that attracted me at the first age was Ramana Maharshi. No big sectarian movement, no drum beating, no big razzmatazz. This is immediately I knew this guy was talking from first experience. Then the other personality that drew my attention were, of course, the personalities of Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna. They stole my heart. In fact, they were blown my fuses, if I can use the right word. So I've been strongly attracted to these ideas that have been promoted by Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna.
So in your talks, you speak about how consciousness and existence, which I think you call like Bhati and Asti, kind of make up the spirit, and then the spiritual world underpins kind of the material world. So could you explain a bit more about that and how you think this realization can then help us like more personally, and maybe how that's actually affected your outlook on life?
Janvi, you sound like my daughter. I'm very pleased to have made contact with you. I studied physics and maths, and I loved maths. So when my daughter was growing up, I said, study physics and maths. She said, Dad, go away. I like physics and stuff. So I had great problems. So nice to meet up with somebody like you. Say, yes, I like maths as well.
Yes, I love maths. That's good.
Let me touch on the ideas of the deeper. You see, the Hinduism comes in two flavors. Most Hindus don't know about this. 99% of Hindus are focused on personality-oriented Hinduism, Vishnu and Shiva and Mother Goddess and Ganesh and Hanuman. Perfectly fine, but this is just one part of one flavor of Hinduism. That flavor cannot sit well with science, I'm telling you. The other flavor of Hinduism, which is kind of much more esoteric and much more philosophically oriented, is called the Shruti scriptures. And that doesn't have gods and goddesses. No interaction between gods and goddesses. It's talking about nature of reality. What is the nature of reality that we encounter? So it's immediately something that's close to my heart, physics. So what is the nature of reality? Now, our ancient seers, sages, they didn't have telescopes and, you know, Hubble telescope or microscopes. They were looking inward to find resolution to the human condition and the world that we lived in. And through tremendous introspection, we hit the jackpot. You see, people think knowledge comes from outside. It is already within. We just need to remove the clutter to make it visible. So our ancient sages were able to remove the clutter to see the nature of reality because the knowledge is already within. It just becomes revealed. And they discovered some of the marvelous things that are now being rediscovered by modern physics. I'll give you an example. The ancient sages said, the underpinning to this reality we define as Brahman, or Brahma is the right pronunciation. And when you say, please give us some handle, you know, Brahma, what the heck is it? Some vegetable? They say, no. The nearest handle we have, look at the language, very guarded. The nearest handle we have, linguistic ploys we can use to understand the idea of Brahma, is the idea of Asti, Pati, Priya. It's of the nature of existence, it's of the nature of bliss, it's of the nature of consciousness. You say, but they sound like almost human thing. What is this existence, bliss, and consciousness? They hit the jackpot. They recognize, they realize the underpinning to this reality is not matter, which is something dramatically different, which is highly abstract. Because when it's existence, how do you define existence? Or how do you define, you know, consciousness? So they discovered that they found the underpinning to this reality, which is best expressed as Sat Chit Anand or Asti Bhati Priya. Now, this may have been okay for those esoteric Hindus who love Adi Shankara and Vedanta and all that. But you say, how does it relate to the world that we live in? Because people here are, you know, making money, etc. What is this? Asti, Bhati, Priya, what the heck is it? Now, through the integrity of science, this is why I love it. Through the integrity of science, we discover major kind of black holes where issues are not being resolved. And these black holes are revealing the same thing that our ancient sages were talking about. When you ask a physicist, a quantum mechanist, how do you define the quantum phenomena? What's the nearest physical way to define it? They say very simply, this is called the psi function. I won't go into the detail, but the psi function tells you what is the probability of existence. See, the word existence appears like a thunderbolt in physics, quantum mechanics. It is of the nature of existence. So there is no reality, it's just nature of existence. So quantum is pointing the idea of existence underpinning this reality. It is a shudder, a variation existence that creates the universe. This is quantum physics. So it's, wow, good stuff here. And then you go to a neuroscientist, you know, Susan Greenfield, and say, oh, what is the nature of consciousness? She said, Mr. Lakhani, don't ask. We have no clue. We don't know where it springs from, which slice of the brain produces it, what is its nature, but we seem to have it. It gives us access to reality. We don't know what it is, where it comes from. It remains unknown. We say, we told you, consciousness is not a brain phenomena. It requires a brain to flow through, but what consciousness is far more than brain phenomena. Vati, underpinning to reality. So straight away, find wonderful ideas at the heart of modern physics and modern neuroscience that relate very well with the esoteric. Look, not the personality-oriented Hinduism. They can't stand the challenges of modern physics. If they come with in full flow with the with the integrity of science. So we are rediscovering what the ancient sages discovered as Asti Vati, right at the heart of modern sciences.
So I guess if you've had this kind of experience, how has this kind of changed your outlook on life as in a more physical way? So like how is this like helped you kind of personally?
Help me? It has not helped me. It's destroyed all my hair. They've fallen out. The way you judge your personality, I'm not trying to promote myself. The way you judge your personality is whether the vibrancy with which that personality speaks about spiritual experience reveals whether it's for real or whether it's just making it up, which is book learning. So only thing I can say is, look at me waving my arms, doing Bharatanatyam all the time on television. It cannot happen unless I've been kind of driven by this very dynamic experience that is anyway driving the work I do. So in a way, the way it reveals in me is the way I do the work. With tremendous love and tremendous excitement and tremendous, you know, sense of humor. This is the sign of spirituality. So I'm not promoting myself. I'm simply saying these are the kind of litmus tests of what a person becomes enlightened.
You spoke about spiritual humanists versus like material humanists. Do you think they could ever work together at all? Or do you think it's better that everyone realizes spiritualism?
I'll give you my personal take. I've been a very personal friend of the chief executive of British Humanist Association, who promote the idea of materialistic humanism. And I think my own professor, Roger Penrose, is the vice president. And I think Richard Dawkins is also vice president. So they're all kind of strongly linked up in British Humanist Association. Now, the chief executive has been a wonderful friend of mine for many, many years. And we have a tussle all the time. You know, I tell him, look, humanism is perfect. Focus on humanity rather than God in heaven. I like you. I say, I like you. But add a word. Make it not materialistic humanism. Make it spiritual humanism. And he said, Mr. Lakhani, go away. So we hear this tussle all the time. And once on the internet, I said, materialist humanism is lifeless. He said, how dare you call us lifeless? We are full of life. I said, but you are saying you're a lump of carbon. That's lifeless. So we hear this all the time tussle. I have a big debate with a chief philosopher called Peter Kale. And this debate was on the British Humanist website. But I think I was winning the debate. So I think they've taken it down. But I put it on my website. So you can still read the dialogue because we are having a tussle. He's saying everything is nothing but extension of the material kingdom. You're nothing more than lumps of matter that got wound up through accidental evolution. This is the idea of evolutionary biology. We agree with Darwin that we are the extension of the animal kingdom. But then Dawkins said, no, you're extension of the material kingdom, Mr. Lakhani. You're nothing but lumps of carbon that got wound up through accidental evolution, this complex being. That's nothing more to you. Then that case, you destroy my dignity. You turn me into a lump of carbon, wound up lump of carbon. You can be, you know, I can be flushed down the loo. It's terrible. I'm not happy with that. You must add the word spiritual. And there is a big fight going on. And they won't allow it. Even though some, in their heart of heart, they know there's something more missing in materialistic humanism. Because in a way, it reduces us to nothing but lump of matter. Now, you can't say this is dignifying humanity. So we love humanity. But in the same, you know, world, they say you are nothing but lump of matter. This destroys the whole idea of what we are all about. According to me, we are not material beings conjuring up ideas of spirituality so that we can live well with each other. That's what they are claiming. I am suggesting opposite. We are essentially spiritual beings on a fun material journey. So we kind of, yoo-hoo, but the underpinning to us is spirit. Janvi, let me tell you, when I do debates, discussion at many schools, sixth forms, universities, I steal the hearts and minds of the thinking youngsters. They all know intuitively there's more to them than just matter. Because it can't be just matter. That's why the British Humanist Association struggles with kind of youngsters participating because they appear stodgy. It appears very rational and good to focus on humanity and be good human beings, wonderful. But still something is missing. And what is missing is the word spiritual. Now, you know what will happen? It is in this particular decade, not century, this decade, this idea that I'm promoting or suggesting that comes at the heart of Hinduism, spiritual humanism, is going to become mainstream. I just want to make sure I live long enough to see it happen. Now, really, I'm not joking. Janvi, you can smile and please pray for that. I love live a long life. But this is going to become mainstream. It cannot be avoided. They're holding the floodgates back, just hanging on to materialism. They can't think outside the material box. All the scientists like Richard Dawkins or my own professor, Roger Ben, he can't think outside the material box. I'm saying, no, you have to get out of materialism. This is, in fact, restricting you, taking away your dignity. So this is an ongoing struggle.
So do you think, like, in some way, we're kind of scared of looking introspectively and actually like considering that we're more spiritual than material? Or is it just, we just can't think that that could be possible?
Danvi, it is inevitable. All of us, somehow the inner compass that we possess know, tells us that we are more than material beings. Even though we kind of look at ourselves in the mirror, say, oh, I'm so clever and looking, so look above my arms. We know there's something deeper within us, which is not the material frame. And that thing is intuitive. Not, look, human, this is how the story of evolution. At the animal level, we operate at the level of instinct. Fair enough, that's how we could survive. Then we enter the human kingdom, then we got intelligence. So we operate at the level of intellect. This is where Richard Dawkins and Stephen Hawking are, or Roger Penrose are, operating with the level, oh, we are intelligent animals, but still we're animals, extension. But then there's a third dimension that they don't want to acknowledge. It's intuition. It's nice to start with instinct, intellect, and move on to intuition. Some of the major scientific discoveries took place through intuition. Intuition, not intellect, sitting in there drinking coffee. You just, boom, we get a eureka moment. It comes with, it pops out from within. See, I told you, the ancient sages discovered that. Through intuition, they discovered the deeper dimension of reality. So the story is still going on. It's an ongoing story, but I keep shoving myself into their lobby. And the boys at Eton said, Mr. Lakhani, have a debate with Richard Dawkins. And they said, Mr. Lakhani, if you have a debate, what will happen? He said, you will win. I said, how can you be sure? They said, because he's just a biologist, you are a physicist. And physics can trump biology. I said, good, I go for it.
Agreed. Yeah, definitely. So that's actually really interesting. I completely agree. Like, I definitely think we're so spiritual and like the material, I completely agree with this. Sometimes you speak, you want to define kind of living things and you say that it's kind of in defiance with physical nature. And I found that really interesting. Could you maybe like explain more about that? And do you think ever that like we're being really harmful to nature at all? Or like, is that important?
It's important that we don't harm nature or harm other living things. That is, again, a central feature of our tradition. In the Abrahamic tradition, they say man was put on earth to rule over animals, basically butcher them and eat them. Our tradition is, no, we are a continuation of the animal kingdom. So sacredness throughout the living kingdom is our speciality. So we have no difficulty. That's why the gentle cow became, yoo-hoo, caught in the center straight, saying, this is a special animal, give special respect. This made humanity settle down and become civilized. So we recognize the role of all the living kingdom. We have no difficulty with that whatsoever. So we agree with that, this idea of giving sacred status to all the life forms. But we are somehow cursed to live on other life forms. We are cursed, all of us. The best thing we can do is live on the least evolved life form than the most evolved life form. This is how you get the idea of vegetarianism, idea of veganism, etc. This is how it comes along. So basically what we are suggesting is that the living kingdom cannot be ignored. And one of the features of our living kingdom, because you go to, everybody goes to biology classes and then GCS and A-level, all that. And that's how do you define a living thing. All the definitions they give fall short of the target. I just give examples. Suppose they define living things that which gives birth to other living things, you know, reproduces, birth gives birth. And of course, you show the mule and so the mule is waving his tail. It's not supposed to reproduce. That means, is it dead? No, it's still alive. Okay, then you say, living things are those things that consume and excrete. Then you look at your four-wheel drive car. It consumes a lot of petrol, excretes a lot of carbon dioxide. Is it living? They say, no. Then you are a physicist. They say, refrigerator, from high entropy to low entropy, brings from disorder to order. Your refrigerator does that as well. You know, it kind of reduces the wiggly water into ice cubes. So is that alive? He said, no. So every definition you have somehow falls short of the target. And yet, you combine everything, that's what living things are. In fact, the best definition about living thing comes from our tradition. I'm really proud to say that. Living things, according to us, this is the best definition, are those things that are not in compliance with the forces of nature, but in defiance of it. Because if we're just output of nature, why should we defy nature? We should play along with the forces of nature. All living things are nothing but defiance, standing up against the forces of nature. When we're, ancient man was cowering in caves, shuddering, cold, and lightning falling, God sending messages. In no time we learned, this thing can be harnessed and, light up my house and my office. So we are not in compliance with forces of nature, we are in defiance of it, we want to harness it and sit above them. Why? If you're just extension of the material kingdom, we should just play along and roll over. But we say, no, we don't like to roll. We don't like to roll. Even amoeba won't roll over. He said, no, don't do that to me. the thing that is showing a living thing is something special because it stands up against the forces of nature. It is not in, look at the language, it's not in compliance with the force of nature, it is in defiance of it. Straight, this is the biggest kind of challenge that can be given to Richard Dawkins. He said, no, it's to just to maintain the genetic pool, but why should he maintain the genetic pool? Why? What's the big deal about that? So the fact that you want to stand up against nature is the clearest sign of a living thing. And this is what we promote. There's something special here, doesn't like to be pushed about. And that thing we define as Atman or spirit.
Earlier, you mentioned that they're kind of like two main kind of schools of thought in Hinduism, like 99% of people are focused more on the personality aspect versus the 1% focus on what you deem as like the more important part. How can we maybe get the others to realize that this is maybe the way to go forward rather than focusing on the personality bit, or are both equally important but just both need to be focused on?
Janvi, both are important because human beings progress at their own pace and there is a slow pace and we mustn't push it because the thing is we must disrespect people from where they are. So if somebody's been brought up in a very traditional family, focusing on a super personality, I'm not here to undermine him. I'm simply saying, carry on. But then you will slowly, as you evolve, or become more closer to your own deity, your own god of choice, you'll soon discover a deeper dimension. I'll just give a simple example that I use at universities. I'm not here to undermine this kind of focusing on any kind of great deities of Hinduism. I say, carry on, my friend. This is what I tell them. See if it appeals to you. I say, suppose you love, say, Vishnu, and you want to worship Vishnu, or Vishnu, I want to come in front of you. Vishnu says, okay. And suppose you are so fortunate, you get sight of Vishnu, perhaps before you die or perhaps after you die. Suppose you go in front of Vishnu, and you'll fold you and say, Vishnu, I've arrived. I've come here. I love you, Vishnu. I love you. So Vishnu says, yes, I know, my boy. I know. Calm down. No, but I love you, Vishnu. And you sit at his feet and keep praising him. Vishnu, your eyes are like lotus flowers. Vishnu, I know, I've seen the mirror. No, leave me. No, I love you. I'm deliberately lightening up a serious issue. Do you know what is the apex of love, Janji? Apex of love is where? No, I'm just not putting you on the spot. The apex of love is where the person who is in love cannot see himself or herself different from the object of his worship, the object of his devotion. So at this height of your apex of love, suppose you love Vishnu that much, you keep looking at him, you love him. Do you know what is the apex? You can't see yourself different from Vishnu. You say, oh, you become Vishnu. You can't see yourself apart from the object of your worship. This is the height of love. And what happens here? You're transcended a kind of a more personality-oriented Hinduism to a principle-oriented Hinduism. You are the ultimate reality. So this is how at experiential level they meet up. But at the same time, millions of Hindus are devoted to all the various kind of gods and goddesses. I'm not here to undermine them. I'm simply saying, take you on your journey to your destination, see what happens to you. You will go from the personality to principle-oriented Hinduism in the most natural, experiential manner rather than intellectual manner. So be it. I'm not here to, suppose somebody requires crutches to make progress, spiritual progress. I'm not here to kick the crutches away. So, no, come on, grow up, principle-oriented. It can't work. They have to move gradually from where they are. You know what I've been taught by my mentor? Swami Vivekananda said, if you can help somebody progress spiritually from where they are, not where you are, do so. Otherwise, fold your hands and step aside. Don't interfere. They are progressing at their own pace from where they are. If you can help them to progress in their own mode from where they are, not where you are, then do so. Otherwise, hold your hands and step aside. See, what a beautiful, what a magnanimous message. That is the method I try and use. But sometimes I have to take on the challenges, especially when the challenges come from science or rationality, this personality-oriented approach fails. And they come rushing to me and say, Mr. Lakhani, but did the creation came out of Vishnu's belly button? I say, no. This comes from the esoteric Hinduism, the idea of Big Bang, visible there. So move from personality to principle if you're forced to do so because science and religion, science and rationality will keep challenging you. This is my way. I do it in a very gentle manner.
I see. Okay. That really helps, and that's given me a lot to think about as well. Thank you so much.
So how have you seen Hinduism change over your lifetime? So just in terms of maybe like the beliefs of the Hindus that you're interacting with. So do you see maybe like a kind of generational difference in how Hindus are living their lives?
Yes, I've seen a tremendous amount of evolution already taking place. Tremendous. The first thing is this. Hindus who struggle with the idea of personality-oriented Hinduism, they struggle big time because if they take these ideas to their science lobby or to their place of work, they'll be laughed out. So they struggle. So they kind of hide themselves saying we are Hindus because the thing's a weird religion with elephant head gods and all that. So they hide themselves or become very much on the back foot. They're always in the defensive. They don't know how to respond. So I see this struggle all the time. So when the Hindus struggle with this personality oriented Hinduism, they have to look deeper. And some just basically say, we'll ignore it. Just ignore Hinduism as a weakness in our tradition. They think it's a weakness because this personality oriented Hinduism cannot stand up to the challenges that come from science and rationality. So they run away. But now I'm seeing quite a lot of youngsters today, I'm very pleased to say that, are now prepared to embrace the deeper vision of Hinduism without feeling compromised. Because then they feel like we can respond in a dramatic manner. What modern world requires is something that you already possess. But because you've not looked at it, have not valued it, you can't really push it across. When I go to Hindu societies, I used to travel to all the Hindu societies throughout the country, been to Oxford many a times. I discovered that basically the Hindus themselves are struggling and on back foot. So when I give them these ideas that are at the heart of Hinduism, they become lit up. I'm not exaggerating, they get lit up. I give you the ideas that will light any Hindu up. You see, the first idea is this. This idea of focusing on a God in heaven is struggling now throughout the world. Majority of youngsters that I come across, Hindus as well as non-Hindus, quietly say they are atheists because they can't tolerate a God in heaven creating this world. It doesn't sit well. So they're becoming atheists or agnostic. So the majority in some schools, 90% are atheists, bluntly. So the most revolution is taking place. They are moving away from a monotheist idea of ultimate reality. They're moving away. So they're now moving to the idea of something more to us rather than say God in heaven. The focus is now turning not on a God in heaven, but God in humanity. And this is visible naturally. If I ask him, atheist, do you believe in God? He'll say, no. I say, do you believe in yourself? He said, of course I believe in myself. I say, caught you. What you are searching for is not some God in heaven, but for your essential nature. So in this manner, the modern thinking youngsters, Hindus as well, especially the non-Hindus, even more than Hindus, let me tell you, fall in love with this idea, something special about themselves, not a God in heaven. And this idea is called spiritual humanism. It steals hearts and minds like that. In fact, when I did certain assemblies at Eton College, the Eton headmaster, he was a good friend. I mean, he's moved away now. He said, Tony Little, he said, Mr. Lakhani, you can do assembly here, but our boys are very naughty. They'll gang up together and tear you down, pull you down. Because when you give an answer, two more will put the hands up. No, sir, you're not answered. They'll keep bothering you. They're really naughty. Michael Heseltine came here last week and they made him turn red in the face. Watch it. I told the headmaster, please don't worry about me. But when I do the next assembly, sit in the front row and see what I do to your boys. In the moment I started working with spiritual humanism, without any hesitation, they started applauding before I could finish. Forget about challenging me. They fell in love. You see, they've been told that from birth they are sinners. Suddenly this guy is telling them they are divine, essentially divine. And there's no sin. They are not sinners by birth. First time they've been released from this kind of binding. They are sinners right from their birth. Just because they're born, they're sinners. And suddenly this Mr. Lakhani is giving them tremendous dignity. So they start applauding. They stand in a line to shake my hand. So I see I've caught their attention. You see, this is the idea at the heart of Hinduism. Something great about humanity, something great about all living things, which is essentially spiritual rather than material. So refocusing attention on humanity is the way forward. It's happening naturally. And I'll be very frank, Akash, not to Hindus. Hindus are slow to catch on. It's the non-Hindus who catch on to it very quickly. I'm discovering that. That is why BBC won't let me lose. Because I steal all the hearts. These are very dynamic ideas, very potent ideas. So rather than the future of Hinduism is, you know, look, you heard that, you know, used to see this advertisement, the future is orange. And I felt very nice. I said, yeah, I knew it. But then this is a telephone company. but ironically, that is true. The future, I'm not trying to score a point on the religion or the human. That's not our style. But the material we possess is so potent. We'll see the hearts and minds of millions of people in days to come. I want to live for 10 more years. I'll see it happen in front of my eyes. We have got very important ideas. Look, do you know how you win somebody's, not by throwing bombs at him or killing him or murdering him or swords. And the best way to win hearts and minds is through ideas. They are the most potent thing we possess and we have them. Except most Hindus don't know. Their hand is kind of like this. They won't open their palms to see what they possess. They possess the most dynamic vision.